Light the candle, tiger!
Hi there, welcome along to the Racing Post Golf Postcast. I'm Bruce Millington, and in the company of Steve Palmer and Star Sports Glenn Day, we will be looking ahead to two great tournaments either side of the Atlantic Ocean. Hopefully plenty of winners among them as the Tour Championship or the Race of the FedEx Cup boils up. First though, we'll look back on last week, just one tournament, and Patrick Reed won. He was kind of on the periphery of the top 10 of the betting, Glenn, wasn't he? So I'm guessing he was a reasonably good result.
Yeah, not bad. We saw a bit of money for him. Small winner, sort of 40-1 sort of price.
He's not that sort of popular with punters. He's not very charismatic, is he? So I'd guess he's the sort of guy who, even in play, they don't all go mad for.
No, definitely not. No, yeah, he's, he's made himself a bit unpopular, but I think he comes across okay, personally. I mean, he upsets people more on the golf course.
Well, it's funny because I saw a good tweet there where it was like an image of someone handing over a baton and it said, world's most unpopular golfer. And the caption was, here you go, Bryson. Thanks a lot from Patrick. So,
yeah.
Obviously, Steve, you were away last week, weren't you? Were you under canvas?
No, I was in a caravan. I was in Sandy Balls, the amusingly named Sandy Balls in the New Forest. Just had a few days with the family there. So, yeah, recharging the batteries. But I got back at the weekend and saw the final two rounds and was devastated by Patrick Reed's victory because I know you always ask me whether I would have had the winner in my absence, and I'm almost certain I would have done.
Oh, would you?
Yeah. I normally gleefully respond in the negative, don't I? Because there's nothing better than coming back and knowing that you've won money by not betting. But yeah, I think it was the opposite case this week, because we were all over him for the Wyndham the week before, and he finished that event with a 63. He's been dropping hints for several weeks. So yeah, I think I missed out on a big price winner there, and I've only just got over it in time for this podcast.
Oh well. Did you pick up on the Bryson DeChambeau hoo-ha?
Yeah. I picked up on everything. I mean, I couldn't believe the aggression in his interview after the round. I mean, he was really just unhinged, wasn't he? Just wasn't making any sense. Did you hear?
I didn't see that. No, I didn't. I've only seen the venom that's gone from other players towards him.
Well, he was asked a couple of very innocent questions by the media about it, and then he just went off on one for approximately the same amount of time as he took to take that 10-foot putt, and he was just he wasn't making any sense. He seems to have really been angered by the fact that he's been singled out for this. But you know, he is one of the pioneers of slow play. He's ridiculously slow, isn't he?
Yeah, that video was ludicrous, wasn't it? I mean, you know, you're right. JB Holmes has been at it as well, but there's plenty more, aren't there? They just spend ages. And as the quick players all saying, it's quite nice to see how many quick players there are. You know, Brooks Koepka and Rose have come out in criticism, and obviously Eddie Pepperell calling him a twit. I mean, imagine apologising. What sort of world do we live in where someone has to apologise for calling someone a twit? Eh?
Yeah, I did see Eddie withdrew that statement. But yeah, I mean, I'm happy to call Bryson DeChambeau a twit. If you're watching this, you are a twit. And but he's not the only twit.
It's the PGA for not policing it. Who's the commissioner who said that, you know, that they really don't want to start docking people points? It's the only way to sort it out, and it would sort itself out in no time, wouldn't it?
Yeah, they are the bigger twits. We should use a much more nasty word for them, because it is a simple solution, isn't it? You've got a $15 million prize check going to the winners of the FedEx Cup. I mean, how difficult would it be for the PGA Tour and the European Tour to have an official with every group, you know, timing them and delivering instant penalties for slow play? You can employ a team of 200 people for that. You know,
they're going to use the ShotLink people, because obviously there's a kid watching every group, isn't there, presumably, to provide the ShotLink details. And I think they're going to give them a stopwatch, so they might be able to monitor it that way. But it's the only way to sort it. And as soon as you do dock people shots, the problem will go away. It's so simple, and it's ludicrous that it hasn't happened, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm a severe disciplinarian in all walks of life, really. I think, you know, if you impose a 10-year prison sentence for burglary, there'll never be any burglaries. But, I think in this case, You know, we need a bit more discipline on there. Bryson needs to be told you will lose shots for that sort of behaviour, and then, as you say, it stops instantly.
I wouldn't mind, Glenn, but it was a poxy putt as well, wasn't it? It flashed about 7 inches past the hole. It was pathetic, wasn't it? Where do you stand on slow play, Glenn?
No, I agree totally. I was thinking of the slow play, not penalising players. It's the big name players, you see, they don't want to penalise. Didn't they penalise that young lad in the Masters?
They did, yes, you're right.
That's fine, no one knows him, he's a bit slow, I'll dock him a point, Mr. Stupid. And on the other hand, that shot clock Masters, whether you agree with it or not, but I think only one person got penalised in the whole tournament. So
they should all be the shot clock. They should all be the shot clock Masters, I think.
Yeah, possibly, yeah. I mean, that's off the tournament list this year, so I don't know why.
That's,
but
that's a fine
I would have put more of those sort of things just to try and get people into the habit of doing that. Yeah, or you do get penalised as a, you know, not many big names played it, and that seems to be the issue, right?
Okay, well, this won't fatten your wallets going on about slow play, so we'll speed it up and we'll go look ahead to our first tournament, which is the BMW Championship at the historic Medina course. Steve, before we get a show of betting, what sort of test is Medina? It is Medina, isn't it, or is it Medina?
No, it's Medina, yeah, the famous number three course at Medina. There's a few courses there. This is the championship course, 7,600 yards, par 72, long parkland, softened by rain recently, so plenty of yardage to cover, small greens. It's hosted five majors, most recently the 1999 and 2006 USPGAs, both won by Tiger Woods. And it also staged the 2012 Ryder Cup, you know, the so-called miracle of Medina, when Europe fought back from 10-6 to win that. And it's played quite easy. Woods won with winning totals of 11 and 18 under par in those USPGAs. It was a birdie fest in the Ryder Cup because Davis Love, the American captain, slashed the rough. You know, almost no rough for that tournament. So you got four par fives, one drivable par four, and really decent weather forecast. So I think something like 15 under par will win this week.
And does it suit a particular type of player, or are all sort of skills catered for here?
I think you need power because, as I say, it's been a lot of rain recently. It's playing soft. It's a long course. So power is key, and accuracy on approach to these small greens.
Okay, Glenn Day, take it away with a show from Star Sports.
Yeah, 50 odds, six places this week. 8-1 joint favourites, Brooks Koepka and Rory McIlroy. 10-1 John Rahm. 12-1 Justin Thomas. 14-1 Dustin Johnson. 18 Justin Rose. 22-1 Patrick Cantlay. 25-1 Adam Scott, Patrick Reed, Webb Simpson, and 28-1 Tommy Fleetwood.
And what's the tournament rating, Glenn?
Not surprisingly, again, a 9.
Yeah, it's got to be a high 9, that, hasn't it? Blimey, look how far down Tiger Woods is now all of a sudden. He's tumbled down the betting, hasn't he? Incredible scenes. Right then, Steve, you're putting up four players, and the most fancied of them is who?
The best bet is Justin Thomas, who is one of the freshest players in the field. Coming into these playoffs, I think a lot of players are running on empty. Thomas had a six-week break in the middle of the season with a wrist injury. And in the last few weeks, he's looked really, really hungry for success. He's built up a head of steam. He's swinging absolutely superbly. He finished 9th in the Scottish Open, 11th in the Open, 12th in the WGC St. Jude, 12th again in the Northern Trust last week. And all those performances were on courses where he had precious little course experience. He was a course debutant in three of them. So to finish just off the first page of the leaderboard is impressive, and he's had a really cold putter throughout. So any upturn in putting form, and I think it's bingo for Thomas at Medina, which is a track which really suits him. Small greens put less of a premium on putting. The key attributes, as discussed, he's got power on tap. He's second on the PGA Tour for strokes gained on approach. So this is a perfect fit for him, and he's desperate to keep his winning streak up. Every year since 2014, he's won a tournament. He hasn't won a tournament in 2019. He's not scared by these bumper paydays. He's a former FedEx Cup champion. So I think you know, he relished the chance of winning a second FedEx Cup title. And it's also an important factor to, you know, talk about Bryson DeChambeau again. I mean,
he's not paired with him, is he?
Well, he played with him for two rounds last week.
I know he did, yeah. I saw the video. It was amazing, wasn't it? He was looking at his watch and getting very upset about it, wasn't he?
Yeah, so you wonder whether that unsettled him enough to stop him winning last week. You know, he was just off the pace last week. No, this week he's playing with Paul Casey and Adam Scott, you know, two fine, you know, genial characters. And, yeah, I fancy Thomas quite strongly, actually.
You do? Okay.
I do.
Just... I was looking at some on my phone. I came back. You took me by surprise how quickly you stopped. Glenn, how many are you putting up this week?
Just the three for me.
Just the three. Who's your main man?
Main man? Well, I tipped up Patrick Ree in the Wyndham a couple of weeks ago. Now, I left him out last week. So the fear of a repeat of that and the fact that the guy played decently last week, I'm going to headline the Canadian Corey Connors this week.
Oh, don't talk to me about... Well, you'll have to talk to me about it because you're tipping him. But I backed him on your say-so for a top 20 finish last week.
Oh, really?
And the bastard missed from 5 feet on the 18th. And fell out of the top 20 as a consequence. That was a great shout by you, but ultimately, no joy. That was annoying.
I say he played well, I expected it. I say an opening round 66, promised much more. But without seeing too much of him in the coverage, he was hitting too many fairway bunkers, which snookered his chances of getting in the frame. Got the required length off the tee for this week. Regularly averages over 300 yards. But obviously, it's his iron play, the standout part of his game. Highlighted that when he won his maiden tour event at the Texas Open, firing 10 birdies in the final round. Only one of those required a putt outside of 12 feet, suggesting how good the iron play was. I'm going to bore you with some stats here. Currently ranks number one on tour in greens in regulation. He's sixth in greens in regulation from 200 yards plus and number one from 125 yards in. He's 7th in greens in regulation from the fairway and 11th from anywhere other than the fairway. He's a greens in regulation machine. Pre-signed this season, ranked in the top 7 in driving accuracy, and one of those with the tough Bethpage Black in the PGA. So in hope he has a better week off the tee and keeps it in the short stuff. He also ranks number 1 in proximity to the hole from the fairway, and a decent week with a flat stick, he can put in another good show.
Has he got the cojones to win a tournament of this magnitude, do you think, Glenn?
I think that's what I looked at this morning. He's another guy that's played on all the tours, the Latino America, the Canadian. He didn't have a lot of form with them. Last season, he found a bit. Obviously, the win, he dipped in form immediately after, like a lot of maiden winners. But recently, he started to show that he can play with the big boys. And I definitely think he's got the game for it. It's just the mental side now. And the more he's in the mix against these sort of guys, I think the more comfortable he'll be with it. I definitely think he can win these sort of tournaments in the future.
Corey Connors, a 150-1 headline shout there from Glenn. Excellent stuff. Who's your next best, Steve?
My next best is Brooks Koepka. I realise sticking an 8-1 chance in makes this an expensive staking plan. I apologise for that, but I think it'd be foolish to go into battle this week without at least a win-only wager on the FedEx Cup leader. I know a lot of people are ruling Koepka out this week because they feel that he would have switched his attention already to the Tour Championship. But I don't see it like that. I don't think he can afford to see it like that. I saw Koepka on the practice putting green after his round on Sunday in New Jersey. He was grinding with his coach on his putting stroke. I think he knows that the BMW Championship is massively important in terms of setting up that $50 million payday that he's got his eyes on, because he hasn't got a particularly good record at East Lake. East Lake, his form figures at East Lake are 18-6-26. You know, bear in mind it's a 30-runner heat. That's pretty poor form for a player of his stature. East Lake, not a particularly good fit for him. So with Rory McIlroy, John Rahm and other world-class players breathing down his neck in the FedEx Cup standings, I think Koepka knows it's very important to stay number one in the standings and get that two-shot lead for East Lake. I don't know whether you discussed that on previous podcasts.
Oh, mate, we did it to death last week because we're really concerned about betting chaos next week with the leaderboard showing the sort of gross scores rather than net scores and all that kind of thing.
We'll see. Now, I'd be interested in the chat with Glenn if we've got time on how he's going to approach that, because I assume that bookmakers are going to bet on the FedEx Cup, employ the handicap system in there.
Never assume, as David Brent said.
Hopefully, as there's only 30 players, they can do both.
Well, what I'm expecting, Steve, next week in the Racing Post is a lovely story explaining it all, speaking to all the bookies and getting their views on how it's all going to work, because otherwise it could be very, very confusing. But anyway, back to Koepka.
Yeah, yeah. back to Kupka, and Kupka needs to keep his foot on the gas here, because there's 2,000 FedEx Cup points on offer to whoever wins this week. Anyone down to 40th place in the standings can mathematically overtake Kupka this week. So he needs to focus on the BMW Championship. I think the Tour Championship starts now for Brooks Kupka. He's got 144 holes left to complete his season. He knows that Medina, you know, a long soft course with 4 par 5 suits him much better than East Lake. He needs to stay in the number one spot. So yeah, Kupka's my next best.
Who's your next best, Glenn?
My next best is, Steve's done all the work, Justin Thomas. Agree entirely what Steve said. Running into form, iron plays great. He's got good stats, green in regulation. He's got to start holding some putts soon. And he will win soon, I'm sure. So he's my number two.
All right then. And Steve, the other two are?
The other two are Patrick Cantlay, Mr. Consistent of the PGA Tour, rock solid each way bet this week. 14 top 20s in 19 starts this season, including a victory in the Memorial, third place in the USPGA. He's sixth in the FedEx Cup standing, so very much in the hunt. And should take a shine to Medina. He putted superbly last week and finished 12th at Liberty National. You know, typically a greens in regulation machine, a bit in and out with a putter, but you know, really hot flat stick last week. If he brings that to Medina with a more typical tee to green performance, I think he contends for BMW glory. And then the final one, very popular on this podcast at the start of the season, Jason Cochrack. Jason Cochrack came agonizingly close to winning the Valspar Championship at 50-1 for us at the end of March. As I say, brilliant start to the year from him. Had a bit of a flat spot in May and June, but then the Cochrack has raised his game again in recent weeks. He was sixth in the Wyndham Championship, 12th in the Northern Trust last week. Medina sets up great for him, so another good chance for a maiden victory.
Okay, and you've got one more selection for us, Glenn, haven't you?
Yeah, and Steve's done the work again there. Jason Cochrack, as Steve said, an amazing year. One missed cut, finding his form again. I'm looking at his putting stats, they're not very good. I remember the first time I saw him, first time he came into prominence, 2012 Friars.com Open. I was watching him, I thought this young lad's pretty decent, hits the ball a million miles. But it was in the days when, I can't remember what channel it was, they used to get him to grade their own game. And the interesting thing for me was that he ranked his putting as an A+. And I like that combination, guys that can hit miles and are good on the green, or at least he thinks he is. I've seen him have the odd good round, but he needs to put it all in. And obviously, when he does that, that's when he'll get his first tour win.
What do you mean by grading your own game?
I can't remember what channel it was, but they used to grade. So, you know, off the tee, how far you were in.
Oh, just for a bit of fun, yeah?
They graded themselves. And, you know, you've got to be quite confident in your rookie season to grade yourself as an A+ for putting. But he's never quite done that. So good rounds here and there. He obviously can putt, but he needs to do it consistently. I mean, last week ranked 72nd. So there's still a question mark there. But I mean, obviously he's got good game. So he hits it a long way and he's a very good iron player.
That's a very flamboyant staking plan there, Glenn. I've got to say, should we spin through the other leading contenders? Just a very snappy line from each of you on the following. Steve, what do you think of single figure price Rory McIlroy?
Third in the standings, 2016 FedEx Cup champion. Fond memories of Medina. Met his wife there. You've been following all that story. It was a lovely story. In 2012 Ryder Cup. You know, he was late for his tee time. He misjudged the tee time. Was going to miss his tee time, and then Erica Stoll, as she was then, came to the rescue and tracked him down and got him on the phone. He was actually on the phone to Caroline Wozniacki at the time. It's a fascinating story. We could spend 10 minutes on it, but it won't help punters.
But and then she stole his heart, did she?
Well, she stole his heart with some brilliant work. Got a police car to get him to the tee on time, and then he beat Keegan Bradley, and then Europe won by 1 point. So he rewarded her by dumping Caroline Wozniacki and marrying her.
So, that is interesting.
So he's got fond memories of Medina. He won 3 points in that Ryder Cup. He's obviously playing great, but I think he's got mental scars from the Open and from that WGC drubbing from Brooks Koepka.
Okay, John Rahm. I do love John Rahm. I laid him odds on Sunday, and he went and bogeyed the next two. I do not trust John Rahm. Do you, Glenn?
No, exactly. That's why I've got my note. Threw away another golden opportunity in a weekend. Did it in the Players earlier in the year. You just see him chuntering away to yourself. That's never going to help you in the business end of a competition. Way too short for me at 10-1. Got the game.
He hasn't got the temperament, has he?
No, not at all.
Okay, DJ showed a return to form for 2 days, Steve, and then it all went very, very wrong. Can he bounce back here?
No, that's right. I mean, you should have seen me chuntering, right, Glenn, when Rama's doing that, because obviously that invited reading, and I was doing a lot of chuntering. But yeah, Dustin Johnson, he started well at Liberty National, didn't he? But then weekend rounds of 74 and 73 plummeted down the leaderboard. He won 3 points from three matches in that Ryder Cup. So Medina, you know, Medina suits him well, but he's not driving well. He keeps switching putters. He keeps switching putting grips. No, I can't have him on my mind.
I used to remember, Steve, when we used to work together on the sports desk, you'd chunter like mad if someone was whistling in the office, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I know. I've got temperament issues, and I just do a lot of chuntering. I keep reading books to try and sort me out, but none of them have cracked it yet.
Okay. Well, you chunter away in that lovely shed of yours. Right then, Justin Rose, who was second in this last couple of years. What do you think of his chances, Glenn?
Yeah, so I'm saying the same thing about him every single week. He's posting good finishing figures. His game all looks in good order, but he's not quite getting the job done. I say he's got tournaments in him again, but just at the moment, not quite there.
Steve, you've had the hots for Webb Simpson the last few weeks. Do you think he can figure here?
Well, I heard he cracked his driver last week, so yeah, he's got to sort himself out a new driver. No, not an ideal track for Simpson. I need a bit more punch off the tee for this one.
Okay, and finally, Glenn, what do you think of Adam Scott's chances?
Yeah, again, tee to green, he's got it all, hasn't he? Hits it far enough, great iron player, but the questions start on the green. He has his good days, but generally they're few and far between, so the putter always holds him back, so he'll be up there or thereabouts, but will he have a chance to win it? I'm not quite so sure.
Who would you rather be, Glenn? Webb Simpson or Adam Scott?
Who would I rather be?
Yeah.
Adam Scott.
Why?
Looks.
Okay. If we could make this a regular feature, that was good. On to the European Tour, which reappears after a few weeks of inactivity. Is that down to lack of sponsors or just the schedule or what, Steve?
Sorry, I'm still chuckling away at Clint, Kent on there.
I can't argue with it. I mean,
no, I would pick Adam Scott. Well, because Webb Simpson's very devoted to the Lord, and he spends a lot of time at Bible classes and in the church, and that's quite, you know, it's quite a lot he puts on his plate there. And Adam Scott, you know, does a lot of surfing, and you know, as Glenn points out, probably had a very active youth.
That's not what Glenn said. Right, can you answer my question, please? Why do we not have any European Tour events at the height of summer these days?
Because of the FedEx Cup schedule changes, the European Tour basically have just surrendered to the behemoth that is the PGA Tour.
Okay, right. Well, what we've got is the Czech Open. Is it? It's called the Czech. No, the Czech Masters. Czech Masters. It's at the Albatross Golf Club in Prague. And Glenn, what is the latest betting from Star Sports, please?
Well, again, we're 50 odds the first six for this one. 10-1, Bern Wiesberger. 14-1, Eddie Pepperell, Eric Van Rooyen, and Lee Westwood. 18-1, Thomas Peters. 22-1, Andrea Pavan. 25-1, Robert McIntyre and Tom Lewis. And 28-1, Gavin Green and Julian Suri.
Glenn, you know, sometimes in football you get teams and they say that they don't want half-time to come because they're playing so well. Do you think with Wiesberger, he wouldn't have wanted this little European Tour hiatus to come because he was absolutely flying? I'm going to go to you first and just ask you a yes-no question. Are you tipping Wiesberger this week?
Yes.
You are. Is he your number one?
He is my only selection.
Oh, excellent. I preempted that. A treat, didn't I? I thought you'd stick with him. Go on then, elaborate, Glenn. Why are you going all in on Wiesberger? Looks?
No, not looks with him, I'm afraid. Not that he's not a good-looking young chap, but I'm going to go big hitters here and take advantage of the generous fairways of which he's won. But all previous winners here have ranked very highly. Greens in regulation, with the exception of Thomas Peters in 2015, who ranked 22nd. The other four winners ranked 2nd, 1st, 2nd and 6th. Putts per green in regulation has also proved the key stat, with the winners ranking 4th, 1st, 2nd, 2nd and 1st. When you apply all those factors and the current form, as we've said, there is one standout player, the aforementioned Austrian Bern Wiesberger. And his last seven tournaments, which include a 76th at the US Open and 32nd at the Open, he's five tournaments outside of that. Obviously, his figures are 1st, 8th, 16th, 2nd and first. Excuse me. Although only ranking 62nd in driving distance on the tour this year, we know he's long enough when he needs it. Of this week's field, over a period of the last 15 weeks, he's fourth in greens in regulation, and of the top 20 in that category, he's only second behind Robert McIntyre in putting. His victory in the Scottish Open was against a much better quality field, including the likes of Rory McIlroy, Justin Thomas, Ricky Fowler, Henrik Stenson, etc. And this field is nowhere near the depth or quality of that. He held everything he looked at in Scotland and has performed consistently with a flat stick this season. The short break will also have done his chances no harm. He won in Denmark after a week off, was second in the Irish Open after a week off before winning in Scotland. I see no reason why he can't have a third victory this year.
Okay, Steve, really, you're going to have to go some to convince me not to be putting all my eggs in the Bernd Wiesberger basket here. But I believe you have got four against him, haven't you? Far away.
Yeah, I'm not going to stop you putting eggs in the Wiesberger basket. I was stunned he wasn't favourite this week. I thought he should be clear favourite, but he was actually co-favourite of four, which was astonishing. But a key fact about Wiesberger, he qualified for that WGC St Jude Invitational and turned down the opportunity to freshen up for the end of the European Tour season. So, I think Wiesberger's got a lot going for him. But, yeah, I got four at bigger prices to beat him. Julian Suri, American powerhouse, very well suited to this layout. Fond memories of the Czech Republic. It is where he kickstarted his career by winning the 2017 Czech Challenge on the Challenge Tour. 3 months after that, he won on the European Tour, the Maiden Denmark. He's one of the best players on the European Tour. Took 5 months off with a hernia surgery last year. Came back at the end of March and was straight back at it. 24-2-19 for his four starts back. He was 15th in the Andalusia Masters at the end of June. His one spin on this course, he was sixth after three rounds. And then shot a final round 76. But that event came straight after his Denmark maiden win. So, a bit of mental, the mental tank ran dry. So Julian Suri, number one choice. Next best is Tom Lewis. Only Shane Lowry and Danny Willett outscored Lewis in the final three rounds of the Open Championship. A superb 54-hole stretch from Lewis at Portrush. Finished in 11th place. It was a timely fillip after a bit of a flat spell. In Prague last year is where he started his golden spell. He was world number 428, then finished 10th in the Prague Golf Challenge on the Challenge Tour. He won a Challenge Tour event by five shots soon after that. He won the Portugal Masters by three shots at the end of the year, charging up the world rankings. He got to 55th in the world rankings after finishing third in the Saudi International in February. And then he went off the rails a bit. He started qualifying for WGCs, a lot of globe trotting, but he's back in the groove now. He's back at one of his favourite tracks. He finished third and sixth at the Albatross the last 2 years. So Suri and Lewis, the best bets. Two more, Gavin Green, the 2017 Asian Tour Order of Merit winner, rising star. He's quickly settled on the European Tour. The best result of his rookie campaign last year came in this event. He was third in the Czech Masters. The course sets up superbly for him. He's been very impressive lately. And the final one at a bigger price is Hayden Porteous, 2017 Czech Masters champion, another ideally suited to this test. He loves playing in the Czech Republic. His girlfriend is a Czech. And he's had a couple of tidy warm-up spins in the Scottish Open and in a Sunshine Tour event last week. So, I think Porteous could be ready to roast the Albatross again.
Lovely stuff. Okay, quickly, Glenn, could you endorse a bet on my favourite European Tour player of the moment, Robert McIntyre?
Do you bet?
Could you endorse a bet? If I said I was going to back him, would you say, oh, don't do that? Or would you say, that?
No. I mean, as you mentioned last week, I don't know why no one wants to know him this week. Obviously, as I said, in the patting stats, he comes out very high. But I've got on my notes again, as I said the other week, Dunhill links for Robert McIntyre. I'm not sure this will necessarily suit him, bring out the best of him. But, yeah, a few weeks' time, Dunhill links championship, then you can go all in, Bruce.
Does no one want to know him this week?
No, no one at all, no.
Bobby, if you listen to this, mate, I want to know you. Play well. Probably doesn't. Oh, well, so right, it's now time for the solemn summary of the selection. So if you missed any of what the lads have said throughout the broadcast, now's the time to jot them down again and lump on, or have sensible bets, rather. So the BMW Championship, Steve Palmer.
Justin Thomas, Brooks Koepka, Patrick Cantlay, and Jason Cockrack.
Glenn Day.
Corey Connors, Justin Thomas, and Jason Cockrack.
And as I always say, now that's not me chirping in and saying back Glenn Day. That's me telling Glenn Day what his tips are. Does Glenn Day still play golf? to the best of your knowledge, Steve?
He's on the seniors tour.
Oh, is he? He's on the old round bellies, is he?
Yeah. He led one of the majors earlier on in the year after one round shot, 8 under par, I think.
I'll tell you, it's lucky he's not still playing. He'd get called more than a twit by Eddie Pepperell. He was the original slow player, wasn't he? Okay, and the Czech Masters, Steve Palmer.
Do you think a twerp's more offensive than twit?
I think they're both great? Nothing. I cannot believe you ever have to apologise for calling someone a twit.
No, me neither. Czech Masters, Julian Sully, Tom Lewis, Gavin Green and Hayden Porteous.
And Glenn Day, who do you like?
Just the one, Bernd Wiesberger.
Brilliant stuff. Are you going to have one of your more significant bets of the year on Bernd, do you think, Glenn?
I definitely am, yes.
Lovely stuff. Do you talk all the people around you into the office as well? You got all like young kids and, or, you know, the young lads. Do you sort of say you got a lump on?
Yeah, but apparently this week everyone's going in with a double. So a lot of pressure on me this week.
What's the double? Wiesberger and who?
Connors.
Oh, really?
A retirement double.
Wow, God, that is going to hit people. Oh, yeah, we better do that, actually. If you only had one golf bet, is that yours, or are you just going to go all in on Bernd?
No, that'd be it. Yeah, got the double, yeah. Want to retire soon, so.
Okay. Steve, what's your one golf bet this week?
My one golf bet is the Justin Thomas and Julian Suré each-way double. It's the Justin and Julian show this week.
What have are you going to buy yourself? Your
hang on, I've got a wisecrack.
I've gone.
What are you going to buy your wife on Monday morning?
What?
Just jewels.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. Justin and Julian.
Yeah, that's really, really good.
I prepared earlier.
Have you done that bet yourself, Steve?
I have, very much so. Yeah. That's the deficit killer, the deficit spitter.
Oh, lovely.
The 2019 deficit, that's always my target now, to get level for the year. So.
Brilliant stuff. Any other good stuff before we convene next week? What have you got lined up? Because you just got back from your holes, so I suppose it's all down to the grindstone, isn't it now?
Yeah. I've got to look after both children tomorrow night for the first time ever. The wife's going to get a haircut, which always takes about 4 hours. So, it's the first time I've been a lone parent of two children. So, it's going to be a big test. That is a test.
You'll be all right. You'll be fine.
Well, he's very dependent on mummy's udders, isn't he, old Tommy? I haven't got them to offer.
There's ways and means. There's bottles and all sorts of stuff. And Glenn, what have you got that will excite you most between now and next Wednesday?
Nothing's going to excite me this week, I'm afraid. I'm doing a 6-day week this week. Four next week and decorating next week. So, nothing to get too excited about.
I'd have thought a man of your stature and pay packet, you'd pay someone else to decorate, no?
I wish, yeah, I wish.
Okey dokes.
This weekend, Bruce.
Well, quite, yeah. If Wiesberger and Connors get it done, you'll be getting a new house to decorate. Never mind getting the existing dwelling decorated. Right, well, let's talk about what is coming up next week, because it's the Tour Championship, the culmination of the FedEx Cup. Like I say, there's a bit of confusion because players are going to come into this 30-runner event with head starts based on the points and the earnings they've made already. But Steve and Glenn will have researched it all, and by the time we sit down next week, they'll have it all sorted out. And we are also in Sweden for the Scandinavian International. Between now and then, we've got football podcasts. And Maddie is here on Friday to present a bumper weekend of racing, including the Hungerford Stakes. But if you can't join us for them, we'd love you to be back next Wednesday for another Racing Post Golf Podcast. Give them the horn!